So the title is Multinational Enterprises, Location and Globalization Process, because there is a double move, a dialectic between location and globalization process. And I would like to underline that there are new challenges for theory and for economic policy. So I will mix three kinds of approach: firms, trade, and balance of payments, and data also, three kind of data. And the idea, the key theory resides in financial combination of between financial globalization and technological revolution. I will present the theory of technological informational revolution. So, I'm sorry, I would like to have both. Okay. First, to begin, definition. I'm a statistician, so I need definition. A very simple definition, mere definition. We can have a more complicated, not taking into account the size. We will define a multinational enterprise for us, for me, as an enterprise with at least one legal unit in France or at home, and one legal unit in another country, but under the same control. And I will explain later deeply what is control. So, one point, there is a multinational enterprise specificity, and to summarize, I will theorize this specificity, which is, it is an object, an entity which is here and there, jointly. That is the question. And that potentially changes its relation with home territory or with the boss territory. For example, you can observe profit here and not investment, and investment there, and the reverse. Investment here without profit, and profit come from outside. And it's not only anecdotic. So, to fix the ideas, some animations. The country, domestic, France if you want, in blue. Other countries, okay, foreign. And we can divide the domestic firms in three parts. First part, multinational enterprise domestically controlled, okay, with several legal entities. And multinational enterprise foreign controlled, okay, with their legal entity located in the economy, let's say in France. Oh, it's good, I like to move. So they are defined because they control legal entities in other countries directly or indirectly, indirectly in the third country or indirectly in the same country, okay? And multinational foreign controlling. And don't forget that there are French firms, and they are compound with independent firm, sole legal entity, but also pure French groups, only compound with French legal entity or domestic legal entity. Okay, some figures, because now statistical institutes can measure the importance of multinational in several countries. It is a set of statistics which is named FATS. I will come back to it, but I can write to you FATS statistics, like FATS Domingo, foreign affiliates statistics. Okay. The T comes from the fact that before it was foreign affiliate trade statistics, and then broader view, and it is not only about affiliates, but mainly about multinational. And OECD takes those statistics inside a set of statistics which is named M, activity of multinational enterprises. Okay. So there are figures. And for France, we can say that half of employees, business and banks, work directly in a multinational enterprise. I don't speak about subcontracting or anything else, only directly in a multinational enterprise, you have half of people who work inside it, with 5 million in French-controlled, 1.8 million in foreign-controlled, and the other in pure domestic. Okay, and we know also those are called inward fat statistics for foreign, and those are enterprise group statistics. And we know also from outward fat statistics, the outward part, the part abroad, only for domestic French, domestic controlled multinational. And you can see that there are 5 million of employees, more than the number of employees located in resident legal units. More than half outside. Okay? And for the value added, it's more or less the same and more, because before it was little less than half, and that there is more or less than half, 57% of value added of banks and enterprises. Okay? And we don't know sales outside, we don't know value added that's outside, only sales, sorry, it's in French, sales outside, directly by affiliates established abroad. And it is 1,200 billion euros. So also one half of their sales, global sales. Okay, that is to fix the ID. So it counts a lot. So we need to say something about it and maybe something specific about it. So point two, interpretation of multinational enterprises functioning and development and theory. I would underline two driving forces. The first driving force is more evident, so it is important, but I will not stay a long time on it. I will stay more on technology. Financial globalization is the first driving force. There are fluidity, I don't know if it can be said, fluidity, yes, of international payments, openness of current accounts, which is a process, it's not yet complete, fluidity of international investments, foreign direct investment, portfolio, etc., repatriation of profits, which is between those. Okay, more and more fluidity. It is a driving force for multinational, and you can say also that currency zone as euro is also a driving force for an easier working inside multinational enterprises. But the second point I would like to underline is technology. I use the theory of informational revolution, and I will explain it a little bit because it's not very well known. It is informational revolution theory is an interpretation of the process of the new technology presently. The idea is that there is a very important difference between informational revolution and industrial revolution that we have before, two or three industrial revolutions we had before. There is one thing which is the same. They replace man or woman by machine. But in industrial revolution, it is the hand using tools which is replaced by machine tools. And it has taken a lot of time from the end of Middle Ages with the mill until now. Okay. And it is a force that developed the efficiency of work and the productivity, the global productivity, okay? Now, the machines we have, they replace certain functions of human brain. What kind of functions? Information treatment and transformation. They are replaced by machines, computers. And it is different, because information is shared, or could be shared, in nature. And a tool could not be shared. A machine tool is here, and it is not there. Or if you want, let's take, for example, pharmaceutical industry. Okay? A big tool when you mix paracetamol, okay? Very big. If you want to have it in France, in Vitry-sur-Seine, and if you want to have the same in USA, you have to pay double price and to rebuild one or to displace it. But the information, let's say, the formula for the medicine, for paracetamol, the formula, you can share it simultaneously in the two locations and with quasi zero cost. So information is shared in nature and could be simultaneously here and there. There is the notion of ubiquity of information in law. It's very different to machine. For example, chemical formula for medicine. And so the information is the formula shareable between all affiliates all around the world within a multinational enterprise. And that is the main new thing. New, I mean, for 20, 30 years. And this formula is taken under the form of a patent and a financial asset. But the information is not the financial asset, it's not the patent, it's the formula. Okay. And you can go further thinking of the software to implement the formula in the machine and the process for processing machines. Okay. And if you elaborate it in one location, for example, if you don't speak about medicine, you can speak about tire and Michelin firm in center of France. You can elaborate the software to drive the machine tool. And as soon as it is elaborated, you can use it in several locations. So the separation between information, tool, and man is completely changed. We got a factor with a simultaneous use in several locations. One, I mean, global production factor and not local production factor. And it is very different from Ricardo or Echeverlin Samuelson theory, because in this theory you got one factor in one country. There are other differences. For information, there are the question of sunk cost, so high initial cost, like R&D, and quasi-zero using cost. Because once it is already created, the sharing of R&D cost can be made as a sharing of quasi-fixed cost between affiliates all around the world. So it is a driving force for the development of multinational as a network, a bigger network to share a fixed cost, base of development of new kind of multinational enterprises. Okay? That's, I think, the main theoretical point, I think. So now I will skip to some kind of description of multinational enterprise, MNE, multinational enterprise, or multinational corporation, as you like, multinational enterprise activity circuit. Location or localization of activities and globalization of results and resources. So I will show that there we have a playing on those two sides, as you read. So you come back to the paper now. You are reassured. So first, there are processing of located activities, different located activities in different locations. Okay. Results of activity, they are located, I mean, products. Some of them are used in the same location, wages and material products, taxes, etc. And some of them can be globalized, and you have second globalization of results and resources. For example, research results. They are the result of an activity, and they can be globalized, or also profits and financial. Financing can be globalized at the end of the process. And they can also leverage on international national resources in the economies and territories, either financial resources, bank system of different countries, or informational resources as the links with firms and university in different locations, etc. You can develop. Okay? And so you have a new set of globalizable resources. They pool the resources. Okay? And then there is a process of re or delocation of activities. So developing the same location or developing other location, localized activity, new or same localized activities, and new. And at each point, there are the question of criteria to decide and transfers, because resources are globalized and they are transferred from one location to the other. And the transfers are the second important point that I want to stress on for you. And also transfer here. Okay? So, now, the idea is to take seriously this word of transfer. Because if you read all the literature about multinational enterprise, they use sometimes the word transfer, transfer price, etc. But with no theoretical contents as a word, by the way. But transfers are fundamental, and I want to stress that they are opposed to exchanges. I explain, but first, I propose to take the word trade, like international trade, as compound with transfers, intra-firm trade, and exchanges. Exchange is? Yes, comparison, same value. If you have usage value and exchange value, when you sell a product, you have not yet the use of the product, and you have in compensation the exact value of the product in counterpart. But if you are an affiliate, and for example, I'm the head in the same multinational, I can transfer to you, you have the use of the asset, or not the asset, the use of the information, for example, or the use of what you want, of the products, intermediate products. But I have also the use on it. And what you pay to me, maybe some compensation, maybe nothing, maybe some kind of internal tax in the multinational, it doesn't matter for that moment of the relation. Of course, it will matter at the end. So trade, it is compound with transfers and exchanges, and we have to take transfers seriously with its theoretical sense. So what is the specificity of a multinational enterprise? It's an actor which with its own coherence, and an actor which articulates different territories or countries, and also different activities. And not only different activities, but different economic operations or moments, operations in the sense of national accounts, for example, because they make production and circulation and distribution and financing inside. And our economic framework, production is for firm, circulation is for the market, distribution also, financing is another, it's another thing, but they integrate the whole. And distribution or compensation could be a state or public entities, subsidies, but they make a part, as a part, all those operations together. So we have the originality of multinational enterprise, qualitative originality, and their quantitative importance that creates a new situation compared to traditional economic representations. Okay? It's clear? It's not complicated. So I repeat, transfers, they are to be taken seriously at a conceptual level. Transfers as opposed to exchanges. No equality of values. And or not value at all. Because, for example, in Alcatel, multinational enterprise Alcatel, when you are an affiliate of Alcatel, the rule until 1 year ago, maybe it has changed, the rule is you have to pay some percentage of your sales to the head for global spendings, global expenditure of the head. And in counterpart, we have a free use of all patents and technology. So when you use the technology, you don't pay anything. It's completely disconnected. And if you don't use, you pay. If you use a lot, you pay the same. It depends only on the sales. And in other multinationals, there are other kind of rules. And I think that it would be very interesting to study different kinds of rules, fixation of rules inside multinational, because there are, for one part, driving by taxations and paradise, etc., motives. But also, there are a management incitation, incentive, and affiliates to save production cost or to push sales, etc. So they are the both. And at the end, what is paid must cover the spending, the expenditure for the R&D, for example, for the technology. So physical movement can occur, but or not. It is a sharing. When you share a software, there are a physical movement of electron, but the resource itself stay at the place, okay? So you can keep the using value and open it to the partner. There is not necessary equality of exchange value, or it is equal to zero. We come back to very, very traditional question of economic policy, using value, exchange value. For transfer, how they run? There are different tools, different vectors for transfers, and leverage or lever for transfers. We have transfer prices. We can come back to that later, which are transfer prices are conventional prices fixed inside the group. And I can explain how you can fix it and how you can make profit on it. There are also agreements on royalties, patents, payments, etc. Okay? Vectors. You will see that in financial vectors. Those tools are agreement, and you can see lines of royalty patent payments, interest on loans, international services payments, which includes that. There could be a very important vectors of transfers. Not only, but a lot. And also, you can also use capital flows, capital transfers, as transferring of your value, etc. Okay? So, the lever for transfer is the distinction between control and ownership, which is very important. So, first, the definition of control. The notion, or the concept, is to impose decisions. I can decide one thing in A company, legal entity, and impose it to company C. How? I have the majority of voting rights in company B, so I can impose, and company B has majority of voting rights in company C, so B can impose a decision in C, hence A controls C indirectly. It could be 50% plus one. I take only 60 for the beauty of the example, you will see. So it is the notion, it is to impose decisions. It is measured through the holding of capital. And you know, you can have double voting rights on some shares. For example, you know the family Peugeot and the French car manufacturing Peugeot. They have 18% of the shareholder of the share. But there is a specific mention. If you keep in your name until you under your name during 4 years the share, you have double voting rights. So they have 19, so they have 38 voting rights. Okay? And if there are little shares that public have through banks, normally you will not be able to exert voting rights. So maybe if there is 25 voting rights in the public, so the real voting rights are calculated on 75. So they got some kind of majority. Okay? So that is the control. You can impose decisions. Ownership. If you now the same, but a second calculation. If you calculate how much capital A have to give, A have to give 60 multiplied by 60, 30x% of share of company C. So there is the ownership share, which is 36%. The financing is only 36% of the capital, but you can decide. A controls C, but A has only 36% of ownership in C. That could be said as a group leverage effect. It's like a bank loan effect. It's a group leverage effect because you can impose decision. And for example, how you can do it? Control is decision power. So you can impose the decision of sharing resources, of financial transfer. For example, you impose a level of price, a very high level of price. Is anything against? Okay, I got 60% right, voting right. Okay, it's decided. Hence, there is a lot of profits which come from C to A through the transfer prices. And at the end of the year, when we calculate the profit, it's a kind of residual profit. And then I will have only my 36% on this profit, only the ownership share. But I play on the fact that the control power gives me more power and I can drive profits to my head. Okay? So control decision power, ownership share is financing and sharing of profits, but it's kind of residual profit. Of course, it is more complicated because they can vote or leave the minority. So you don't have to take too much. Okay? But you can have a higher share of profit share than the ownership share, thanks to transfer prices, preferring purchasing, royalties, etc., etc., etc. Okay, for example, there are the example of the uranium in Africa that you can have an affiliate. That feels. It can act only also on countries. Have Africa, France, okay. Uranium here, Bahamas here. And so the uranium will be sold at a very low price here. So there is some value added and taxation on that value added. Little taxation, for example, 10 here, and this will sell the uranium maybe 100. This will buy 100 and sell it maybe 110. So also the taxation base is 10. But the main location of profit is here, 90. Okay? It is very simple way. There are a lot of different ways. I'm not a specialist of management, you know. You have to know that even OECD decided to build a group which is named BEPS. Base erosion and profit shifting. It is taxation-based erosion and profit shifting. But there are a lot of way of doing it. You can use also Belgium from that way, or France in another way. It is not only a question of bad countries and good countries. Depending of the flow, you can use France also. as a good way to do that. Good in brackets, for example, of course. So, three original elements of the functioning of multinational enterprises: sharing of global production factor, and global is important, transfers, and there is some kind of implicit. They make international production in common. This is the idea of new types of multinational enterprises as opposed to old multinational enterprises. Because we had before commercial presence. You make cars and you are multinational and you sell it in other countries with only commercial presence. Okay? Second, you can have different same productive units, replication in different countries. But now we have some kind of splitting of production chain, different stages. And also, not only splitting with some kind of linearity, but also geographic, some kind of transversal functions. You can have transversal function in one location, R&D, for example, and they are used in the whole value-added chain. Okay? And that is some kind of new M&E corresponding to, as I say, informational revolution with that global factor. Okay? So, economic characterization of multinational enterprises. It is a monopolistic form of international co-production, that is important, and of resource sharing by financial control and by transfers. And there is now a new development of that with informational technological revolution. And in some way, they could be viewed as challenged by new technologies because they are built on appropriation and on market, and they use sharing and not market inside. So there is some kind of tension and difficulty from them. But that is a secondary point. So from the characterization, we can see that the multinational enterprise, from my view, performs a function which is necessary, but in a specific form. And if you want to tackle the question of multinational, you have to answer to the function they do. If you want to change the way they act, you have to solve how to make international co-production, how to make sharing of resources. Maybe in another way than in multinational, maybe making multinational acting differently, but you cannot suppress the function. But you have to see also that there is a specific form. For example, financial capital group, whose aim is valorization only of the dominant part of the capital inside the group. Okay? So the question of overcoming multinational enterprise, not suppress it, but the transformation that resolve the function differently. And the idea I would like to stress is we need other regulation of their functioning, another regulation of development than by market prices and capital profitability. Because inside them, they don't use market prices, but they do it for market and for profitability. But already inside, they use other things than market. So we have a need of possibility of other kind of sharing. Some consequences, theory and policy, and some statistics at the end, and I will finish. So, there is the theory of global value chain, you know, conception, and I would like to challenge the idea that, in my way, global value chain is different than global activity chain, because the value is not at the place when you have activity. And it refers to a too much Ricardian view of the production, equality of the factor and the value. But there are transfer and strength. And there is also, behind the value chain, the kind of governance. They list different kind of governance, and they omit the governance by financial links in capital. Geography institution, for example, they are well known. Okay. What you see is not what you get. There are circulation of incomes. And they articulate circulation of values and location of vectors. okay, and there are not a linearity of chain. We need, and we have a lack of theoretical specific analysis of multinational enterprises, and we, and in front of that, we need to integrate multinational enterprises inside the global analysis. We, I have, for example, Yeto Gillis underlined the fact, it is a woman from United Kingdom, and she underlined the fact that we have the multinationals everywhere except in the mainstream of the theory. Because we have theory of multinational completely separated of the rest, separate of the rest. And for example, Krugman made works on multinationals, but in his handbook, Krugman and Obstfeld, no word about multinational except one phrase, one sentence, saying multinational does not have importance in the economy as a mechanism. And also we have in France Aglietta, which omits completely multinational enterprise. I will explain, or Mukeli, I will explain if you want. So we have a lot of research and work that is some kind of paradox. A lot of books, multinational, this, but not an integrated theory. Okay? And I think that some French and also Raymond Vernon had made before some steps in this direction, but there was not viewed and they are omitted. So I can skip the existing theory because if I develop it, we have no time. On est déjà à une heure, mon cher ami. Okay, so I skip it because I have to go to figures, they comment the figures. Okay, but only what is important? There is one kind of theory which is only description and classification of multinational enterprise with transaction cost theory. And but it explains the better is that they explain more or less existence of multinational, but not their consequences and effects. Krugman treats multinational enterprise as a large corporation, nothing very specific in being different part of country, and fixed costs. At firm, the main interest is Elpan, Grossman, Brainard, and Markussen. Markussen is more recent, but Lyle Brainard also. They distinguish fixed cost at firm level. They don't say what is firm, but let's say it's multinational. And fixed cost at subsidiary level. And they say, okay, there are fixed costs at subsidiary level, but also there is a global, they don't say global, I say global, fixed cost at firm level. And that help us to very realistic estimates using American statistics data from BEA, Bureau of Economic Analysis. So, but there are very some difficulties because to which country we have to attribute the fixed cost? It is the question of informational revolution, and they don't treat that question. To which country? Okay? And threat theory is not revised. So what I propose is to distinguish types of factors. We got some global factors and some local factors. And we have global costs and local costs. And they play on the contradiction between and the differences between local costs and global costs, multinational. And what we see in one country is only one part of the elephant. To take transfer seriously, as I said before, and those are effect on cost, local and global cost. Okay. We can have as a fundamental result that multinational enterprise, sorry, it's in French, firme multinationale, multinational enterprise challenges standard theory of international trade because localization of comparative advantage is challenged because you have a global factor and also exchange gain results. And also specialization results, because you have in the you have to add some more hypothesis, because the gain from the advantage, if you have transfer, you can use it in another place, and you will not see in the place. To what place you have to attribute? It is because you have a global production factor as information, and not one production factor in one country. And what we observe in the country, that is the statistician who speaks, it is valuated, but only observed in a country, only a part of the global picture. So we can see that Vernon, Michalet, Heimer have made before steps in this direction. I will not develop. The last point before to go to figures, policy conception. Standard theory say multinational enterprise can be viewed as an imperfection between two perfect free circulation. Free circulation of goods versus free circulation of factors, okay? But they don't give an analysis of own specific rules of multinational enterprise, which is not an average of two kind of rule, it's another kind of rule, okay? Rule of internal circulations and transfer prices. And so you got, for example, Venables and Ali, or Navarrete and Ali, they made a report for European Commission. They insist on rent effect, multinational as a monopoly. They insist on production effect, multinational bring new production by foreign direct investment, by settlement in a country. They speak about spillover effect, R&D, etc. But there is no transfer effect. And that, it is the missing point. So policymakers, they conclude, we have to favor multinational enterprise settlements and improve their performances as a neutral view of performances, as if there is not no adverse effects, but you can, because you can, although you can have yet spillover effect, but transfer effect, no ambivalency, no capital bias. So I skip to statistics. So got FATS, balance of payments. And we know something about multinational. One figure first. There is a European survey, but conducted only on little countries, plus Netherlands and France. So France cannot be compared to others. It is too big in this set of countries. Where we see that 38% of the companies use affiliates abroad to collaborate in the production. So we have that process of co-production international. Okay? And the weight of multinational enterprise, as I said before. Description. Okay. So now to the figure I present in the paper. First figure. As an index of the playing of multinational enterprise on the two level production, financing, and circulation. I take multinational enterprise non-banks. They can have banks affiliate inside, but as a multinational, there are no banks. They are not a banks, okay? And I see, and I mix them, I merge them, match them with balance of payment individual flows, okay? And I see the flows. So if you take only the portfolio investment, they do. They count as 22% of global portfolio flows. So they make financial flows, international flows. Portfolio plus foreign direct investment, 22%. If you add loans, intra-group loans, which are also a financial, international financial flow, you count 26%. And if you add also incomes, capital incomes, and services are mixed, but for one part, you got financial payments, they count of some 30% of the global flows. So it confirms the idea. It's not a demonstration, but it confirms the idea, and it has not been calculated before. That it's on exhaustive sources. Now I would like to show, and it is in the paper, that financial activity of multinational enterprise as a vector of globalization. The idea is when you take only goods, flow with goods, you have activity with less countries than when you take goods and finance. So finance flows are not only compensation of goods, but they enlarge the countries with which you have activity. So I take only non-banks multinational, okay? You can have banks inside, but only as affiliates, like Peugeot have its own bank, Airbus has bought a Munich bank recently, and they say, for example, Airbus group, they bought a Munich bank, I don't remember the precise name, and some say, someone said, okay, you buy it to make advance to customers. No. It is to use the finance of European Central Bank facility. It is in the papers, they say it. So they do that. So if you take French multinational, goods, the number of country is with which they have flow of goods is 22.8. The number of countries with which they have capital and income flows, 13 countries. And some countries are together, so if you take one or the other, you have 30 countries. So the financial dimension play also its partition in the globalization. Because if you see only goods, you will see only some location and you will say, oh, there is no full globalization because it is only with some countries or some sectors, as I said. But if you take also finance, you will see that it is more complicated. And I think that if you take the time, you will see that that financial part help them to enlarge the countries with which they are located during the time. Okay, and it is more for domestic multinational, domestic controlled multinational, because the head and the center is here, and possibly the foreign controlled multinational, they don't use France to globalize finance only as a passing through, and they globalize it in the center. So it is because you have less country, but it had to from 16 to 20 countries. Okay, and we can see that inside multinational non-banks, the financial subsidiaries inside non-financial multinational account for half of financial flows. So they use their own banks and financial subsidiary to do that, but not only. One half of that is done through industrial manufacturing subsidiaries. Okay, and to conclude and to let you the floor, when you know it, you can mix a lot of individual data as I did, and we are in course to continue to do it. But you can also use balance of payments flows and say inside that line, this is more or less transfer payment, informational payment. It is multinational. And when you use that, it's very interesting. So, and I conclude by French, USA, and developing countries to see that multinational counts more today than before. In France, you can have transfer of profits by capital revenue, okay, in percent of GDP from 95 to now. It is more and more, okay, in favor of France because we have a lot of multinational outside and there is capital revenue. But if you add royalties, services, informational services, insurance, etc., this comes from 1.5 to 2%. So it counts, even with a very rough tool as that. If you see Brazil before, that is the external debt. Payments from Brazil to foreign in share of GDP, it was very high in 1985, okay, 6%, and now it is diminishing near to zero. But if you take those lines, royalties, interest, informational services, income from FDI, etc., Then you can have exit profits to capital abroad, because there are multinationals. And you will see that it is now comparable to the level as a percentage of GDP than before. If you take China, you have you know that you have $300 billion of dollars of surplus trade merchandise goods surplus, but there are 200 of exits on the rivers to capital abroad. And that and there is another thing that complicates that. It is because they use it to buy treasury bonds. So there is also, when you include income from treasury bonds, the net is less. So you don't see that process. But there is a first process of multinational who sell a lot, but transfer a lot. And if you take Tunisia, which is a little country that I like very much, as David, that is also the debt exit. So it is not zero now, but it has diminished from the 80s years, okay? That is more or less what we can attribute to multinational enterprise. And it is increasing. And now it is comparable to the debt outflows. And if you take those together, it has diminishing, and now it is increasing. And now it has the same level that it has before when you had the previous political crisis. OK, and that is USA. It's more difficult to see it. Profit on capital with only internal profits, and when we add profit repatriates only on US territories without paradise, etc. And there is a little tendency of higher profits when they use their affiliates abroad. OK, that's all. I'm sorry of being a little bit long.
Thank you once again for the interesting presentation and paper. So we didn't want to repeat the things which was already mentioned by professor in the paper, so we tried to find additional materials about the topic. And let us begin. So first of all, I would like to pay attention to the importance of multinational enterprises, because as economic globalization is spreading all over the world, so multinational corporations are also developed more and more around the world. And here are some of the figures, important facts about multinational enterprises. It is reasonable to say that in 2000, world's largest 500 multinational enterprises had sales of $13.7 trillion. This is the nearly half of the value of all goods and services produced in the world. Also, next important fact is that largest multinationals have revenues greater than the GDP of all but about 20 nations. And also, multinational enterprises are important in international trade, as we know. And about one third of all world trade is between branches of multinational corporations located in different countries, known as intra-firm trade. So, impacts of globalization and growing influence of multinational enterprises. Globalization has facilitated a vast shift in economic activities among various regions and countries, and production and consumption activities have become highly dispersed around the world. Multinationals allocate profits, retained earnings, and record transfer prices in ways that differ from underlying economic transactions for strategic as well as tax reasons. And regarding the issue of main issues regarding to the multinationals are the location of industrial activities and globalization of their results, as it was mentioned in the article. Also, resources that can be mobilized easily. And also, financial globalization is related to so-called located industrial globalization, as Professor mentioned in his paper. Then here are the factors that limited globalization. These factors are one of the factors are is a sector limit to the globalization of the model of a global firm, referring to the rise non-financial linkages. Also, limitations due to internal contradictions in the ongoing process, excessive concentration limited to maintain competition, or existence of corporation size excess and crisis of efficiency and profitability, kind of over-accumulation related to the cost and use of capital. So, Weiling will continue with the key points.
Thank you, Nutsa. So therefore, here we're just going to have a very short wrap up with regards to the paper that was prepared by Dr. BOCCARA. So the first key point was that more localization doesn't mean that there is less globalization. In fact, the paper found that both factors move hand in hand. And also the second key point that came about, which I thought was far more important than the first point, is that financial globalization isn't just about banks and financial players. Multinational companies are also part of the game. And that's why this led to the question that we posed, who's actually monitoring these firms? And also, and the next key point that we gathered from the paper was that we need to relook at international trade and economic theories, as mentioned earlier by Dr. BOCCARA, because it's actually whatever he said much earlier, so I don't want to repeat. And also finally, therefore, given all of the above, it is actually very challenging to implement economic policies because most theories or policymakers don't take MNEs into consideration. But first I want to thank Dr. BOCCARA for his paper, because after reading his paper, I actually now know what I want to do for my master's thesis. It's very related to this. And however, nonetheless, we have some points that we need to seek clarification and also to offer feedback. In your paper, you did mention the limitations of the data. So, and that's why it's a concern, because given that the data is balance of payment data, which is very sensitive, so we will not be able to replicate this data, and also you, especially in other countries, unless you work in a central bank. Another concern is that we have some reservations over the conclusions, because some of the data findings are done without a reference to a certain period in the past, because it's all done based on just one period of time, which was 1998. When the paper concluded that there is a rise, there's an increase in financial activity, but against which period? And also, there's no reference to another country, so you don't have a benchmarking process inside. And that's why I'm just wondering whether was it possible to update the data, or maybe it's because of the limitations to even replicate, you can't even repeat this study because of the change in the balance of payment manuals or the way of how we report the data. And also, the final point that we want to put forth is that the paper do show a very strong defense that there is a link between industrial and financial globalization. However, I couldn't see a very strong argument for the case of localization and globalization based on the data, because I think it was only shown in Table 7. I was just not convinced enough. But the first point was very... And this leads to what other people are actually talking about when it comes to the role of multinational companies. So as mentioned by Dr. BOCCARA, he already mentioned about OECD touching into the BEPS, base erosion and profit shifting. So actually in G20 finance finance ministers actually called for OECD to develop an action plan, of which there are 15 items in them. So that's why I would actually want to hear what are your opinions on these action plans. Whether is it, do you think it's actually feasible? Would it actually address the issue that is with regards to transfer pricing and also tax arbitrage that arise from the loopholes of different tax treatments across countries. So, and because some of the action plans, the deadline was actually in September of this year, but I haven't really seen much reports about it. So maybe from this we can get your feedback on that. And with that, I pass back the floor to Nutsa. Okay.
So as we already mentioned, financial globalization plays important role in encouraging institutions to so that financial markets can effectively perform their function. But sometimes it goes wrong if a country doesn't manage the process of financial globalization properly, and bad policies are the reasons that financial development doesn't occur, or why financial globalization often leads to harmful financial crises. But if we develop some policies that promote successful financial development and the financial globalization, then operation of multinational corporations can be improved as well. And we have some data and some questions related to this issue. So is financial globalization retreating? Because there is indicator that there is 1.9% annual growth of global financial assets since 2007, while it was 7.9%, so it decreased a lot. And there is a 60% decline in cross-border capital flows from their 2007 peak, and 7% other 7% emerging economies share of global foreign investment, inequalities and bonds. But, however, is financial globalization resetting? Because there are figures that 32% of share of global capital flows going to emerging economies in 2012 has rise from 5% to 32%, and also 40% of cross-border capital flows now made up of FDI and most stable types of the flow. And at last, 30% of there is a 30% of reduction of global current account imbalances as a percentage of GDP, and it's a really good indicator. So we leave this to the floor, the questions. Here are the lists of references which we used for our discussions. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor, for the presentation, and thank you, girls, for the comments. I just want to go back to the remark that Weiling said. I think it's really important who gets hurt, but in this case, I want to add who sets the rules and who supervises, because the idea of the multinational enterprises is that they take advantage of also the frameworks, the law frameworks on different countries in order to get the most out of in revenues. So in my question would be, who sets the rules, who supervises, and should this be a government task, or since they are multinational corporations which play by the rules of different countries, should there be a supranational institution who sets these rules and, again, supervises? So thank you.
Now, like, EU is proposing reindustrialization in Europe, but multinational companies usually outsource their manufacturing to those areas with no wages and no labor costs. So do you think like this reindustrialization source in proposals in EU would work and a lot? That's my question. Like, EU is proposing to make manufacturing sector as a advantage to stimulate employment employment issues, and but the multinational companies usually outsource.
Develop manufacturing in France to create more jobs.
But then multinational companies usually would rather outsource their manufacturing.
It's like there's this proposal to Thank you so much for the excellent presentation. I think it really hits at the core of what the structural framework of our program is, and very thoughtful comments as well. So I have two questions for you, and I think one of them has already been asked about the policy implications that when you mentioned that, but it's slightly different in the sense that when you mentioned we have to regulate their functionings, if you can expatiate further on that and what exactly you mean by that, because I think there was less time to develop this point, and what are your proposals? Secondly, I'm thinking of the, they don't listen to them. Yes, definitely, it's on the policy side. And a more controversial one, when you showed the graphs, maybe if we can go back to them. You mentioned how capital is flowing out from usually developing economies. Are you, or can you interpret it as reinforcing inequalities? Because I was thinking of the dependency theory and how capital is flowing out from the core, from the periphery to the core economies, back again. So if you can comment on that as well, thank you.
The reinforcement of inequalities.
Yes. Thank you.
I just wanted to know what state entities do to control companies that are like multinational enterprises that are becoming too powerful and they're sort of causing a negative impact on a domestic economy. What are some of the methods that state governments use to reduce that effect?
And I was wondering what your thoughts are on, well, it's a bit adding to Alex's question, but how we can increase the accountability and transparency of multinationals when it comes to their CSR rhetoric, maybe sometimes, and ambitions.
Hello, it's also related to Barbara's and Alexandre's. I wanted to know your opinion on the role of the WTO, World Trade Organization,
okay.
The role in all the phenomenon, and if it's become an obsolete institution. And Anna-Sophie?
Also, just a comment from your side about the bargaining power of the multinational enterprises, because when they go to big countries, of course they have to bargain. But when they go to developing countries, it's actually developing countries serving in silver platter the welcoming package. So, what do you think about that?
What can underdeveloped countries
do to reinforce their bargaining powers?
World agenda.
Okay, and since everyone is asking you your thoughts about things, I wanted to ask if you know about the investor-state dispute settlement system. And it's very related to what Anna Sophia said, like multinational corporation coming to developing countries and basically suing the countries to impose their standards. And how do you think a global watchdog, in a way, could try to avoid these kind of proceedings?
Hello again. I think, interestingly, we are following up
go on.
So, yeah, let's do this. So, for the WTO's obsolescence she mentioned, and I was in Geneva, and there was this really, really problematic debate with regard to TIPS and TRIPS, which are being signed, and it's all in, behind the curtains. The WTO is becoming obsolete in face of that, and you can actually see that people who work there, their jobs are being threatened. So I would like you, if you can also comment on this in this light as well. Thank you.
Okay.
Good for now.
Okay. maybe there will be a second time. So, I can begin by the first point. It is evident for you that multinationals are big players, but it is not enough evident, I think, because what is important, they are not separate players. Maybe with the exception of USA, there is no country, I think, now that can produce alone. If you say for France, which is an intermediate country but not an underdeveloped country, if you say that one half of the production, business production, is done directly inside multinational, I don't speak about subcontracting, it means that France cannot be cut from the other countries for its economic activity. It's not only a question of income and revenues, but also of pure production. And that changed a lot of things. So it is a little bit outside of your questions, but I think that we have to take it into account. Even when we speak about macro economy, about monetary purposes, like European Union monetary, etc., we cannot produce alone now. And it is true for a lot of countries. And even, I don't know, for USA with China, we don't know. There is something like that. So that is the trend. Second, I have to thank you very much for all your comments, all your questions, and your comments also very relevant and useful. I will skip to policy matters after. I keep the better for the end. But I would like to stress also about figure. When you put 500 multinational account for one half of sales, etc., you have to quote sources. And also, there is because the question is, how is the evolution? Was it true before? Now we don't know, and it's very difficult. It is a puzzling question. Maybe quantitatively there is no so much evolution, and it is qualitative. We don't know completely. But sales is not production. Production is not value-added, etc. And there are a lot of double counting. And as multinationals develop themselves, double accounting develops also. So there is a very puzzling question. But we know that it is very important now. As for the evolution and the criticize to my paper, I agree. There is a high difficulty to replicate the study. And it is a very old year, 1998. Yeah. Yes. Yes. So what about it? First, there has been mind evolution in central banks and national statistical institutes. Now they could be more opened to that kind of work and to conduct that kind of work. I presented more or less the same slides to an international conference between OECD, United States, United Nations, and also the Statisticians conference about my works, and it has convinced them a lot. It was linked to the people which was interested by TIVA. Do you know TIVA? It is now the very fashion. Trade Evaluated. Okay? It is a project at OECD, and it was the working group about TIVA, and they wanted to hear me about that. And so there is now mind more open to that. Because before I did it, and then they close it and they say no. Will not. That's the life of administrative statistician. So now they are more open. The globalization has developed, qualitatively at least, and the difference between value and activity. There is BEPS also, so there is a new conscience about that. We have also other indicators. You have to see the indicators as stocks of foreign direct investment compared to GDP. And they are increasing a lot. Even now, some years after the crisis. In France, if you compare 2000 to now, 2013, the ratio inflows of FDI stocks, inward stocks on GDP, has multiplied by 2.7, three times. And the other ratio, which is outward stocks of FDI on French GDP, 4.7, more or less five times more. So there is, in this increase, there is a price factor of assets, but there is also something from multinational development. And there is a China also during that period. In my study, China was not so important. Beginning to open only at that moment. So, but there is the limitation of the date, I agree. And we have to replicate. And now I can say that we had a bill, an official working group between French Customs, Banque de France, and INSEE, National Statistical Institute. And we share data on specific sectors to make studies similar to that. But as a remark, technical remark, at the moment I made the study, it was not monetary union. There was French balance of payment with the franc, and it was also an exhaustive balance of payments. Each payments were reported either by firms, either by banks on the account of firms. Now it is survey. So it is full of hollow. Because the surveys are based on the legal unit definition of the enterprise, not on the enterprise group. So you can have the manufacturing part of the enterprise and not the transferring part, the bank, etc., which is little. But we can see that it is developing now. So I agree. I am more insisting on the link between finance and industry. And local and global, there are two kind of arguments. One argument, it is industrial is like local and finance is like global. There is some implicit, but it's not all criticized. And there is also the idea that there are global factors as technology, and I analyze it at a more theoretical level. The distinction between, I document with figures the distinction between industry and finance, and the articulation between local and global, it is more at a theoretical point of view. Okay? But also, global is finance between different countries. So I saw that finance between different countries plays a role. So before to skip into the policy. Yes. Retreat of globalization. There was at that moment that question also 10 years ago or 15 years ago. There is always some kind of short-term evolution. In French we say conjoncture, a word that exists in all languages except in English. It does not exist in English, conjoncture. No, they use sometimes, but it comes from French or Russian or Italian, I don't know. Hey, short-term forecast situation, but conjoncture, which is a global view, it's just German, English, German, French, Italian, Spanish, I don't know, Russian also. Kondratiev speaks about linear cyclic conjuncture. So there could be some temporary retreat or some temporary rest, I would say. But there are driving forces also. We cannot be completely inside the data. There are also the theory or the analysis. There are driving forces: economy of cost, saving of costs, saving of capital cost. And we see that foreign direct investment was a little bit more calm, and now it is increasing. Again, foreign direct investment is increasing now. Again, even between countries. And the rest can have also three kind of factors. We had rest maybe until 2012, and now 2013 it is re-increasing, that kind of globalization. Sorry?
I have a question regarding this. I think you're commenting on this slide.
Yes.
And I wanted to comment on the figures here. I mean, they kind of look separate out of the context, like you mentioned. For example, all these things declining, it's immediately after the recession.
Yes.
The economies were overheating. There was a bubble,
yes,
which burst. So maybe the pace of globalization, financial globalization,
it is increasing.
Yeah, it wasn't that fast. It overheated, fell down, but overall it's increasing. So I think the thing about retreat may not be justifiable over the trend rather than after we correct for the recession.
Yes, but in the retreat, we have two kind of factors. There is a macroeconomic factor, because but there is also the individual, the firm level factor. We build the macroeconomic factor, okay. But, and that is the reason why I speak about rest, because that crisis is, for me, some kind of over-accumulation crisis. And so, if you have a macroeconomic global over-accumulation crisis, you can have several multinationals with individual, let's say, over-accumulation. So they rest and they try to reorganize them differently. And there are some kind of restructuring before to re-increase. So, and it could be very interesting to ask that question to the global figures. Do we see that? And what is the shifting between countries, etc.? But you see, the figures I gave for balance of payments in several countries comes to 2012, I think. And there is an increase. So let's skip now to the and there is another thing about the retreat. We have also to take seriously the question of retreat, because it could also has another meaning, which could be changing of the channels of that global movement. For example, there is a high necessity of capital saving. And so there are experimented forms of non-financial capital control of firms. Only to have international property rights, and there are, the question of WTO, etc., but not the expenditure of the total capital. And there is some experiments of saving of capital costs, saving of capital expenditures that can play their role, their own role, to a retreat, an apparent retreat of globalization, which could mean a retreat of different, of past channels of globalization, and we can have other channels. So we have to be attentive and cautious on that. Okay, so now, the question of policy. I think that the policy, the first idea is, I want to stress that before we had to simplify, two kind of proposal. Suppress multinational, nationalized by a nationalization, but nationalization does not only mean public owned, but also only national owned. Or to follow multinational, whatever they do. And the first idea on which I want to insist, that there is a function that must be ensured. That sharing of resources, that sharing of technology, and that co-production using a common global world technology. There is a kind of unity of the world, as some very important economist said, I cannot say it in English. La pourriture, comment on dit la pourriture en anglais?
Rattling.
The rattling is life laboratory. So in some very adverse situation, there is the good which is developed. There is always the two faces. So the idea would be not to suppress or to follow multinationals, but to push other rules and to promote other rules. And in the center of the rules, there is value added. How much global income, how much they contribute to global income, or how much they contribute to territorial, national, global income. So I propose the notion of available value added on a territory. And to see that we have a ratio between global value added, we have the idea is that we don't see value added, global value added. We see available value added on a territory as a part of global value added. So one question would be to promote those kind of ratio. How we can play on that? And there has been a searching on that. When a country imposes national content. But national content sometimes means production content with very little value added, or sometimes can mean value added. And there is also the question of resources behind the multinationals. Where they're coming from, and do we develop it or not? Not enough. Not enough. But you cannot say no. Not enough. Not enough, or not in the good direction. There is also a question of direction. But because we can, and we come now to the theoretical point about WTO. Because if there is a global factor in common, that can be an efficiency factor for all. So if we don't develop it enough, we will be under the optimality, even in your classical view. You can use a recent paper of Bhagwati to argue in this sense, which is maybe the most interesting mainstream economist, Jadish Bhagwati. So the question is, we have to push the resources, research, skills, technology, knowledge, and people, which are the basis for better efficiency of the production and of the sharing. And maybe there is a third thing. So to push the resources, and also, in my view, there is a very interesting thing in the information. Sharing the information develops the information. So if you push the sharing, you develop the resource. For example, now I share my information with you, and with your question, comments, adding, etc., it develops our global and mine and your information. It is completely different if I give you my pen, I don't have it. If I give you my information, I have it, and we can develop it. So the sharing of resources can develop resources. So we need room to develop sharing, and the sharing can be developed not only by saying we need to develop it, but also by people capable to understand and to develop. So we come back to the question of skills and what mainstreams call human capital. So we need that reorientation of criteria, not negate the necessity of multinational production, multinational sharing, but other roles than for capital accumulation and development. So, and that is very different to WTO, because the idea of WTO is competition because there is the rent. And the theoretical framework is there is a rent, we have to find the rent and to suppress it and to diminish the rent, to have the true price. But now, we must push people to share and not to compete. It's very different. And that comes to the question of common goods. So rules of sharing, of mastering trade for developing common goods would be completely different than rules for competition and true price. Even with an international organization, even with those kind of settlements with states at the same level than multinational, I think that states must not be at the same level that multinationals. But even with that, if the rule is competition, lesser price, etc., it is a completely different game if the rule is developing territories, resources, value added on the territories. The settlement will decided on maybe the other side. So the question of other rules, for me, is the main question. So it's very theoretical. If I skip to more, little more concrete, and then very more concrete. Little more concrete. BEPS, for example. They say, BEPS, so the OECD initiative for base erosion and profit shifting, and the discussion. First, they are not very serious. But if we take it seriously without suspicion. Okay. The idea is to find the true price. There is the true price, and you have to sell the thing at the true price, and we have to have the true tax. But the idea I develop is I'm not sure that for some kind of services there is a true price. There is an expenditure. There has been an expenditure. But the price differs if you share that expenditure between 100,000 people or 300,000 people. That is all the question about medicines disputes. So is there a price, or is there a need for expenditure reimbursement and expenditure new development of resources? So, and if you see also the national customs documents, they say, okay, what is a transfer price? A transfer price is a price different to the market price. And then they say, it is feasible to estimate for material goods especially when it is a standardized good. But for some material goods, it is more difficult. And for services, it is very difficult. We don't know, but we try to do that, etc. There is a very high question. We cannot take her with ancient views. It's different. And for example, we had I had to intervene to help the unions in IBM France. Now it is not IBM, it is a joint venture between Siemens and IBM, which is called Infineon. In a Paris suburb, in Corbeil, they made components, electronical components, and suddenly they changed the transfer price rules. Before, the rule was cost plus fee, plus 10%. And the affiliate, IBM affiliate, has to develop himself with the 10% using that, etc., and using the IBM technology. Okay. And now they change and they say it is the market price. But in the plant, they say we have a production as big as the market. So we are half of the market. So what is the market price? They can set it on, but it is inside the IBM. So, and it is very specific because the product had that kind of product, memories, etc. It has only a life of 3 years, 3 years left. So it's very difficult to calculate. We need other rules to calculate. The rule are or some cost, some developing cost, etc., etc. So we come back to common goods and also to the question of public services, because we have to finance public services because they will make possible to continue the development. More concrete, or you have a question? Because more concrete.
Thank you.
Sorry, I hear you.
Okay, I'm not a very strong advocate of WTO, but I think I beg to differ here, because WTO is, you're right in its theoretical reasoning of why it started, because of the policies, you know, when it was formed, the mainstream policies or mainstream thinking in economics was that, to cut this rent which is appropriated through taxes or tariffs, largely, or non-tariff barriers. But then again, WTO and other, they also provide a forum for countries to interact. I see this trend that every time there's a new discussion, or develop a new thing, develop a new body, develop a new agency, a new unit, and in the end, it's just processes that are there in the end. What they deliver is just getting, you know, lower and lower in value. So
okay.
It might also be useful that we strengthen these organizations which are already in place. I mean, for example, there are discussions about that huge question about sustainability these days within WTO, and that's overlooked. So I think, may I mention that your opinions are probably biased in that sense when you say what WTO does or, I don't know, other trade bodies do.
Okay, I'm not also very well aware of what specifically WTO does, except in the statistical dimension. They were at that conference, and they are full of French people, so it's easier to understand each other, even in English, because there was the way of thinking. But I think that if we can take at another level the question, WTO is concentrated on trade exchanges, but we have seen that there are transfers, and they don't even pass through the trade channel vision. So the WTO miss a lot of the puzzle. Maybe IMF has a lot of the puzzle. And it exists, the IMF. It's more politic than WTO IMF. I think that it is at the center of the puzzle, the IMF. And the rule and the opening of balance of payments, it's IMF. And the classification of the lines I use, it's IMF. And for example, IMF decided, if I skip to what I know very well, which is statistics, IMF decided to say you have foreign direct investment, okay? Foreign direct investment, okay? Capital to one country to another, okay? It's money, it's not investment, it's not a, okay, it's transfer of money or all paper. And they say, now, if there is a foreign past direct investment, there is a relation, a foreign direct investment relationship between that company one and company two, okay? So, the classification changed. If there is a loan from that to that, it would be count as a foreign direct investment also, not as a loan. And if there is a loan in that sense, it will be count as a diminution of the foreign direct investment between the two companies. I have suggested it to them. Because before they wanted the story, the full story is that they discovered the real economy after the Asian crisis. And they say, oh, we invest here, but there is a lot of capital here, here, here. So we have to evaluate that investment by the whole capital of the company. And we say, no, we cannot. We have to measure what comes through one boundary to the other one. And so they didn't understand. And I had the idea of saying there is foreign direct investment and foreign direct investment relationship. So now they count differently. And the Netherlands people were very happy of that. And Luxembourg, and now not. Because the evolution of foreign direct investment, the factor of evolution, have changed a lot. Before, by foreign direct investment, you have the attraction of the countries for investment. And now you have an attraction and the short-term conjuncture evolution of loans and borrows between the companies for taxes purposes, or etc. So the IMF is a very important part of the question, because the way they classify, the way they open or not, the way they authorize to have selective policy on that flow will change the things. So that is the first point. Second point, central banks. Central banks play also a high role. And it is an existing institution. We can enlarge then their purpose, their way of doing, etc. But it is an existing institution, as you said. And third, there is also, I think, there is studies to do regarding all the agreements on international investment. There are a lot, there are in France, for the West, there are TAFTA, there are a lot of international projects for investment. There are also between Europe and Latin America, and there are a lot of rules inside. For that moment, the rule is, if it is not possible to ensure the continuity of profitability, it's not good. But you can put other rules. I was in China and we discussed about that also. Because I showed in China, Chinese Academy of Social Science in Beijing, I showed the 300 billions of surplus for goods, but 200 billions of flowing out with multinational. And I said, there is a question of the agreement and all the discussion about the treaty. And what will you do? Oh, we want another, but which? Which rules? And value added must be at the center, and also resources and sharing. Third point, more specific, or you want to...
No, I just wanted to add that, okay, they can ensure profitability, but what about employment? For example, you know, when you have firms like Apple, like major multinational firms that are based in the US, but they want to outsource the jobs outside of the countries, there are no like essential domestic rules to tackle that, and there's no international agreement. So what is the solution in this case to tackle outsourcing, for example?
So it's a good link to what I wanted to say. Okay. Very good. Because we can see how USA do. For taxes, USA, they have a regime of global profit taxes. They don't use it systematically, but it exists. So you tax the global profit of the multinational, whatever it is in the country or another country, etc., if you can measure it, in Caymans and Bahamas, etc., okay, it's another thing. But you can have the profit. The question is, what is the rule of repartition of the profit? And I think one way could be employment with skill, something as the share in maybe purchasing power constant of the wage. And you can divide it between countries that way. I don't know. Or maybe a part if you want to begin. So there is a question of global, I think, as a more specific rules of global taxation based on employment weighted by skills. I don't have the formula. How much minutes?
Five
minutes. So something as alpha profit, alpha gross profit, okay, and alpha E for country E. And alpha E is sum of wage in country E on all wages. And if you want to calculate it better, you take it in a parité de pouvoir d'achat, purchasing power parity. Okay, this is one part. I didn't try to see what implication it has. And the other one is financing. Because that one is good, okay. It depends on the world level, or it depends on agreements between different countries. So how one country can do something. We can also have preferring financing with low interest rates in regard of condition of developing value-added, available value-added on the territory as a share or global value-added. So promoting that question of value-added on the territory in all the political instruments. Because at that moment, I don't know very well the situation of each country, but I think that we have three tools. One tool is to see the transfer prices, but they don't do anything on that. Maybe some agreements hand to hand with the bosses, okay. But attracting, the more they can attract, and promoting the export and the settlement of multinational outside. And they pray to make it more value-added or more employment. But they only pray. But you can put rules, value-added and employment. You will finance at lower cost if it develops employment. And it could be open to all multinational, even if it is British, Chinese, Morocco, etc. Without a discrimination of the country, the rule is the development in the territory of employment and value added. And you play on a lower capital cost. That is elements of the puzzle. Let me see on my paper if I wanted to say other things. So I think that we have to cross the idea of multinational with all the domain of common goods analysis, credit and central bank analysis, and also the question of investment, settlements, agreements, analysis. Okay. We can speak days and days. Thank you.